And make sure. Yes, you are right. I'm now recording. So Jerry Herman, working at the Theatre de Lille, did his very first reviews, and recovering from the death of his mother, it really gave him a little more confidence and so forth. In these reviews that he wrote at Theatre de Lille were two prominent actors at the time, Phyllis Newman, who goes on to win a Tony in a kind of well-forgotten musical called Subways Are for Sleeping. And Charles Nelson Reilly was another person that was in these reviews that he wrote for. And you may remember Charles Nelson Reilly from How to Succeed in Business or from Hollywood Squares. But he was known as one of the greatest comedy coaches for people in Hollywood. If you were involved in a television show or were working on your skill set, he was one of the, he made a tremendous career for himself as a comedy coach, helping actors find their humor within the characters that they were creating. Well, his first musical happens in the early 1960s. It's called Milk and Honey. When Israel was only a 15-year-old country, it was really considered to be very exotic. And it was this exotic nature, and the fact that making a pilgrimage to Israel was really pretty amazing. And it was the idea of a bunch of Jewish women going to Israel to look for husbands, set against the backdrop of this very exotic emerging nation. It was his first really successful book musical after writing all of these Broadway reviews for years and years and years. It's not done very often, but this is a theater in New York that did revive it off Broadway, and you'll hear the directing team talk about it for a
This
moment.
is the land of milk and honey. This is the land of sun and song, and this
Milk and Honey was Jerry Herman's first Broadway score, and it was the show that got him Hello, Dolly! And actually, you see a lot of seeds of Hello, Dolly! In Milk and Honey. You'll see the birth of the Dolly Levi character in Claire Weiss, I think. And there's some melodies that will seem familiar, but obviously unique, and it's a beautiful score. But it's a love story, and it's about the State of Israel 12 to 13 years after it was created in 1948, sort of half a generation of Holocaust survivors who have ended up there. And it centers on two Americans actually visiting Israel. One, Phil, is visiting his daughter, who's moved to Israel to live with her husband, who is a farmer on a moshav, and Ruth, who is traveling with a group of Jewish widows who are touring Israel. And these two people find each other. Phil and Ruth find each other. Neither is looking for love, expects to find it.
She has lived her life very together and polished. She's had to live in that world where she presents herself in that way. She's neglected her own needs. And I think throughout the years, it's just condensed her sphere of life. And maybe it's being in Israel, which is a magical land. It's a magical place. I've been there. I had one of the most amazing trips of my life there. Being there and being seduced by the landscape and the people, and she's exposed to the Hebrew speaking and people walking with cattle on the streets, and everything is so different. And I think she's just a little off balance enough to not fall into her normal thing, which would be to just walk away.
I have been to Israel. My character has a line, "The amount of Hebrew that I speak, you could fit in a salt shaker. The amount of Hebrew that I speak, you could fit right next to a grain of salt. I know maybe five or six words." Toda rabah. That's one of them.
I adore Jerry. I think he's one of the true gentlemen of the world, and just a real mensch. He doesn't have any of that ego that so many young writers do. He was in love with the music. He's in love with the theater. He's in love with living.
What's most interesting about it, I think, and why we are going to do it and why it's important that we do it, is to sort of see in this season when Hello, Dolly! Is here, we're also doing Dear World, to see his growth as an artist. There are some magnificently mature tunes in this show, and lyrics, of course, as well, because he's the same craftsman. So the music and the dance in this piece, I think, functions as sort of the heartbeat of Israel. It's a love story between these people. It's also a love story for the land. And I think I want people to come away with an idea of how to make those connections.
I'll tell you why you should come see Milk and Honey, because this is a really great piece of music. There's some beautiful tunes. Remember those tunes?
Come and see Milk and Honey because nobody produces it.
Well, let's see. Two beautiful songs. One beautiful song for Milk and Honey that he wrote is this.
Shalom, shalom, you will find shalom, the nicest greeting you know. It means bonjour, salut, and skol, and twice as much as hello. It means a million lovely things, like peace be yours, welcome home. And even when you say, you say goodbye with shalom. It's a very useful word. It can get you through the day. All you really need to know, you can hurry along. You're bilingual as long as you say. Nicest greeting I know, shalom, means twice as much as hello. It means a million lovely things, like peace be yours, welcome home. And even when you say goodbye, if your voice has, I don't want to go in it, say goodbye with a little hello in it, and say goodbye with shalom.
It's the most amazing thing that I think I've ever heard. Wait till Berlin's hears of you. Oh, my flowering's done. I'm a native with one little word. Shalom.
Hello.
I find shalom the nicest greeting I know.
It means
bonjour, salut, and skol. Twice as much as hello. It means a million lovely things, like peace be yours, welcome home.
And even when you say goodbye, if your voice has, I don't want to go in it,
say goodbye with a little.
Say goodbye with shalom.
Really a beautiful song. Robert Weedy, of course, was an opera singer who had done The Most Happy Fella. Mimi Benzel was a Broadway actress at the time. And, of course, Molly Pekin was a great stalwart of the Yiddish theater. Well, Molly Pekin gets her own number, and you know, you can tell Jerry Herman's Borscht Belt sense of humor in this wonderful song that Molly Pekin sings to her group of ladies.
So you see, boys, our main purpose in being here in Israel is to form a marriage between the two cultures, male and female. Mrs. Siegel, Cincinnati, finds it oh such a comfort to believe. Though she came here, Mrs. Siegel, Cincinnati, she may come home, Mrs. Levy, Tel Aviv.
Tel Aviv,
Mrs. Levy,
Tel Aviv,
Mrs. Levy, she may come home, Mrs. Levy, Tel Aviv.
Mrs. Perlman, Jersey City, has been thinking how lovely it would be to send home a postal card to Jersey City and to sign it Mrs. Cohen Galilee.
Is wearing gold blue garters and a borrowed blouse.
And Mrs. Breslin has been as busy as a bee, rehearsing an Israeli lyric for Oh Promise Me.
Mrs. Weinstein, Chattanooga, likes authentic Israeli atmosphere. When the tour is behind her, she'd have something to remind her if she carried home a 6-foot souvenir. Now Mrs. Breslin would like a dark roué, and Mrs. Strauss likes temples that are turning gray, and Mrs. Kessler would like a mustache and a cleft.
And what would you like, Clara?
I'd like anything that's left.
You are a wonderful group of ladies. If all of us were not married, we would never let you go back home. Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom, boys. Shalom.
Again, no luck.
So what is it? The end of the world? Pull in your belts. Throw out your chests. And cheer up, ladies. Look around the horizon. Head high, ladies. Don't give up the ship. Look for the silver lining, you gotta go on with the show. Climb every mountain to find your Mr. Snow. And always hip hop, ladies, there's a brighter tomorrow. Stiff upper lip up, ladies, do or die is the plan. Don't ever be discouraged, don't ever be perplexed. There's always another country, Russia may be next. So keep your chins up, ladies. Somewhere over the rainbow there's a man.
Cheer up, ladies. Look around the horizon. Head high, ladies. Don't give up the cheer. Look for the silver lining. Get out of the show. Climb every mountain to find your Mr. Snow. And always hip hop, ladies. There's a brighter tomorrow. Step our lip up, ladies. Do or die is the plan. When the trip is over, but to prove that we were here, we'd like to carry home a 6-foot souvenir. So keep your chin up, ladies. Somewhere over the rainbow there's a man.
Now, if you listen to the music very carefully, what you could hear was the roots of some of the songs in Hello Dolly, and again in MAME. That tune really surfaces again in the score of MAME. Really kind of interesting. Okay, so now let's talk about Hello Dolly and what truly is an iconic musical, one that really put Jerry Herman big time on the map. It's not always a happy story, because what Jerry Herman often said of Hello Dolly was the biggest success of his career, the musical that made his career, was one pile of misery on top of the next, caused primarily by David Merrick, who was one difficult, miserable producer. And these are the musicals that David Merrick, just the musicals, mind you, not the rest of the things that he did that were straight plays. But David Merrick was one impossible human being. And, you know, one of his most famous stories is Subways Are for Sleeping, the story of a bunch of people who took up to the subways for their residences, and about homeless people. And it got mostly disastrous reviews. And what he did was he went to the phone book the day after the musical's reviews were published. He found people in the New York area phone books that had the names of the critics. He brought them all to see the show, gave them free seats, and got a quote from them to run in a Sunday ad that would be as if it was the real reviewer giving feedback about the play. Well, everybody ran the ad except for the New York Times, because they knew better. And Jerry and these publicity stunts were typical of what David Merrick actually did. But Hello, Dolly! Is based upon a Thornton Wilder play, The Merchant of Yonkers, which became The Matchmaker in 1957 with Ruth Gordon. It was performed originally in London. The story of a widower whose wife's best friend decides to set her sights on him for herself. Now, in Hello, Dolly! None of that is particularly clear how Dolly Levi knows Horace Vander Gelder, but, you know, that's one of the flaws with the script. But in any event, it starts off as a very well-received play with Ruth Gordon, then made into a movie in 1958 with Paul Ford, Anthony Perkins, Shirley MacLaine, and Shirley Booth as Dolly Levi. It's really an enjoyable movie. If it comes up on Turner Classic or something, really do watch it because it is quite enjoyable and it became a modest success. Well, David Merrick had always retained the film, the musical rights. He thought one day it might make a suitable musical, and he was the one that kept those going. Robert Merrill was the first choice for the music, but he and Gower Champion, after Carnival, had such a bad taste for each other that he refused to do it, which made then the fact that David Merrick had to find a young composer. Well, Michael Stewart, who wrote the script for Carnival, was really pretty impressed with Jerry Herman's Milk and Honey, and he refers him to David Merrick. Well, Jerry Herman had to write, and Gower Champion, of course, was going to direct, and Gower Champion had already done three hits for David Merrick. One was Bye Bye Birdie, the next was Carnival, and now the third one would hopefully be Hello, Dolly. Jerry Herman had to write four songs as an audition for David Merrick. The first was Call on Dolly and I Put My Hand In, which opens the musical, Dancing, and Ribbons Down My Back. Put On Your Sunday Clothes also was put in there, and ironically, it was a song Jerry Herman kind of pulled out of his songwriting trunk because quite frankly, he thought it was a good song. He wrote the songs in about 3 days and hired Alice Borden, who was in Stop the World, I Want to Get Off, an actress that David Merrick really did like, because he figured if he at least had an actress David Merrick liked who could sing, then he might be in good, connection for the piece. Originally, once Jerry Herman got the part, it was considered that it would be Merman that would do it. Merman, who never said no to anybody, says no to David Merrick. She had just finished for him 3 years in Gypsy. She was absolutely exhausted. Her daughter needed her, and her previous marriage had just fallen apart. She was married to the president of Continental Airlines. She felt she didn't have the strength at this point in time to commit 3 years to this new musical. Now, in those days, if a musical ran a year and a half on Broadway and then the lead actors often took it on tour, it was considered a great success. Well, Merman actually on the right, you see her as they appeared on the Judy Garland show. She was an add-in at a moment with Judy Garland and Barbara Streisand in that classic Judy Garland show episode. But Merman tells David Merrick that she's just not going to do it. And no one ever told David Merrick no, but she made him a promise. She said, I'll tell you what, when you're 6 months out from closing it, I promise you I will come in and do the last 6 months and take it on the road for a year. She was true to that. However, she had no idea it would be 7 years later. Meanwhile, after Ethel Merman turns it down, they go to Mary Martin. And Richard Halliday, who was Mary Martin's husband, quite out said, Mary Martin does not take Ethel Merman's leftovers. If it wasn't good enough for Ethel, it's not good enough for Mary. And if you wanted the first lady of the American Musical Theater, why did you ask the other one first? Well, that came back to haunt Mary, and she takes it on. The next choice was Nancy Walker. But if you remember her, she was about 4'11", and the hats that they were designing for the Dolly were already taller than Nancy Walker. The next person they went to was Nanette Fabre, but she had just been in a musical called Mr. President that Irving Berlin had written, and it was not really a success by any stretch of the imagination. So Gower Champion wanted to audition her. She was highly insulted. She thought that was absolutely ridiculous. Why would Nanette Fabre need to audition? And it maybe was the biggest mistake she ever made in her life, because she probably would have gotten the part and it would have changed her career for the rest of her life. Carol Channing was not anybody's first choice. They went to a great many other people first, but Carol Channing was performing in summer stock on Long Island, and she had been getting really good buzz about it, so they hired a car, they go out to see her, and the only one that couldn't stand her was Gower Champion. He wanted no part of her. He thought that she was just absolutely cloying and wouldn't be successful in this at all. Carol invites him to dinner, hires an accompanist, and performs until 4 a.m, at which point Gower said, "Okay, Carol, I got it, you get it." Well, the title, Dolly Levi, A Very Exasperating Woman, was how the musical lumbered its way into Detroit, where it had its first tryout in November of 1963. It's interesting that David Burns, who was cast as Horace Vandergelder, the emphasis of the play was on Horace, not on Dolly, and the audience has practically left at intermission. The story, it was not holding together well. David Merrick was so frustrated with it that he was actually contemplating shutting it down in Detroit and canceling the next run in Washington. Well, Burns was promised that he was going to get the final song of the first act. And oftentimes things like that are put into contract. And the interesting thing was, this time it wasn't. And what they realized was that the song that ended the first act didn't help the play any. And what they really needed to do was create something for Dolly to end the first act, at which point they go back to the original Thornton Wilder script of The Matchmaker. Within The Matchmaker, there are a great many monologues that Dolly delivers to the audience, breaking the fourth wall. And they go back and they see one where Dolly is literally asking for her deceased husband to give her a sign to go back into the world. They have a meeting on Friday morning, November 22nd, 1963, a very fateful day as it turns out. And several things have just happened. First of all, Bob Merrill is flown into Detroit, unknown to Jerry Herman. Because David Merrick, who has been pitting everybody against each other, has convinced Herman that he can't write the music for this. And Herman is devastated, and it's his idea to write Before the Parade Passes By. But many people think it was Bob Merrill who actually wrote it. Also, they decide that, you know, that Charles Strauss and Lee Adams and Merrill all sit down and do this. And the way they know this really happened is that there were checks that were written to these three people for some musical that never really occurred for the next 25 years. Well, the show, they're having this production meeting, and of course that's the day of the Kennedy assassination, and all of the shows are canceled until the Wednesday night before Thanksgiving. Over this period of time, they work on this number, reshaping the first act, and it really shapes Dolly Levi's character. And the song went into the show and then moves to DC, where it becomes a huge hit.
Ephraim, let me go. It's been long enough, Ephraim. Every evening for all these years, I've locked the door, I've put out the cat, I've made myself a little rum toddy. And before I went to bed, I said a prayer, thanking God that I was independent, that no one else's life was mixed up with mine. And then one night, an oak leaf fell out of my Bible. I placed it there when you asked me to marry you, Ephraim. A perfectly good oak leaf, but without color and without life. And I suddenly realized that I was like that leaf. For years, I had not shed one tear, nor had I been filled with the wonderful hope that something or other would turn out well. And so I have decided to rejoin the human race. I'm gonna marry Horace Vandergelder. And Ephraim, I want you to give me away. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna go and taste Saturday's high life. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna get some life back into my life. I'm ready to move out in front. I've had enough of just passing by life. With the rest of them, with the best of them, I can hold my head up high. For I've got a goal again, I've got a drive again. I'm gonna feel my heart coming alive again before the over there seem to be telling me where I'm going. When the whistles blow and the cymbals crash and the sparklers light the sky, I'm gonna raise the roof. I'm gonna carry on. Give me an old trombone.
Well, that song reinvented the musical, and that monologue came right out of the Thornton Wilder. But this is one of the opening moments of Hello, Dolly, and this is from the revival a few years ago that starred Bette Midler or Bernadette Peters, depending when you saw
it. We're going to New York! Out there, there's a world outside of Yonkers. Out there, beyond this hill. There's lots of worlds out there. Get up the brilliant teen and dime cigars. We're gonna find adventure in the evening air. Girls in white in a perfume night where the lights are bright as the stars. Put on your Sunday clothes, we're gonna ride through town in one of those new horse-drawn open cars.
Just like a dream, your spirits seem to turn upon. That Sunday shine is a certain sign that you feel it's brighter to blow. Yeah!
sunshine is a certain sign, and to feel as fine as you are. Beneath your parasol, the world is all a smile that makes you feel brand new down to your toes. Get out your feathers, your pants and leathers, your beads and buckles and bows. For this other Monday in your Sunday clothes. Beneath your boulder brim, the world's a simple song. A lovely lilt that makes you tilt your
oh my gosh, stop sniveling. Don't cry on the valises. We haven't missed the train yet. Thank the Lord. Lovely, you're improving now. Get all 11 pieces. We're 7 minutes late.
Believed in happy numbers. This is one of the numbers that there is dispute that Bob Merrill actually wrote. Elegance, which opens the second act, many people believe he wrote it because of the style of lyric mangling that he chose, and it's evident in Funny Girl, as a matter of fact, where he did this. But you know, never, no one's ever really been able to prove it, and we can decide for ourselves.
Elegant all my life, but never do it.
Of course, if you want to be really elegant,
we Mrs. Malloy?
Yes, Mr. Hackle?
Mrs. Malloy, as we start inside, may I?
Yes, Mr. Hackle?
May I put my arm around your waist?
Yes, Mr. Hackle. But I might as well warn you, a corset is a corset.
Great opening in the second act. Meanwhile, Pearl Bailey took on the part when Carol, this was a tour de force, a part of their replacement strategy, which we'll talk about in a moment, but you need to see
it
that.
Broke all records during its run.
Ephraim.
Now, why I'm showing you this again is you saw Channing do it, and every actress brings her own approach to a part, and you'll see it's very different. The way Pearl Bailey handled it as compared to the way Carol Channing did.
Let me go. It's been long enough, Ephraim. Every evening for all these years, I've put out the cat, I've locked the door, I've made myself a hot rum toddy. And before going to bed, I said a prayer, thanking God that I was independent. No one else's life was mixed up with mine. Where from? I've decided to rejoin the human race. And I want you. You, Ephraim, to give me away. Before the parade passes by, I want to get in step while there's still time. Before the parade passes by, I got to go taste Saturday's high life. Before the parade passes by, I've got to get some life back into my life. I'm ready to move. I've had enough of just passing by life. With the rest of them, with the best of them, I can hold my head up high. I've got to blow again, I've got to drive again, I've got to feel my heart coming alive again before the parade.
Listen to you, that brass harmony growing. When the parade
that was full of Gower Champion signature choreography. Now, here was Bette Midler doing it. You may say, Steve, why are you showing me all of the same thing? Because each actress brings something different to it, and you'll get a sense of how the style of a piece can feel different with a different actress.
Every evening for all these years, I put out the cat. I locked the door, I made myself a little rum toddy, and before I went to bed, I said a prayer. Thanking God that I was independent and that no one else's life was mixed up with mine. Then one night, an oak leaf fell out of my Bible. I placed it there when you asked me to marry you, Edward. A perfectly good oak leaf, but now without color and without life. And I suddenly realized that I was like that oak leaf. For years I have not shed a single tear, nor had I been filled with the wonderful hope that something or other would turn out well. And so I've decided to rejoin the human race. And Ephraim, I want you to give me away. You fill the parade, passes by. I'm gonna get him while there's still time left before the parade passes by.
Cornelius is taking us down to see the 14th Street Parade.
Everybody will be marching. Why, Irene, you're crying. Oh, Dolly, the world is full of wonderful things.
Come with us, Dolly.
I will, Irene.
Just passing by, like the rest of them.
that was the Bette Midler version. You can decide which one you like the best. Meanwhile, a penny in my pocket was put back in. The song was cut from Horace Vandergelder, and it was put back in as the opening and second act.
I put a penny in my pocket.
In the revival. Quite frankly, it didn't add a thing.
That penny in my pocket had grown into a dime.
So there's a little sample of that. Meanwhile, the big number, the Hello Dolly number, how did it come about? Well, when David Merrick found out that Gower Champion was throwing out $35,000 worth of props, this number actually changes the name of Dolly Levi, You're a Very Exasperating Woman, into the song and the title of the play, Hello Dolly. Louis Armstrong had recorded it. No one knew that he had recorded it, and someone sent it to Jerry Herman, who burst into a rehearsal, screamed at Gower Champion, "You got to stop rehearsal, you've got to hear this." And they played this, and they all could not get over that, you know, Louis Armstrong had recorded it. Louis Armstrong had never had a hit record, and suddenly that song, along with the Beatles' I Want to Hold Your Hand, was going to the top of the pop charts. Sure enough, they decided the song was so important that they changed the name of the play from Dolly Levi, You're a Very Exasperating Woman, to Hello Dolly. Meanwhile, David Merrick keeps threatening to fire everybody if they don't get it into play. And certainly, this is Carol Channing doing the number at a dinner in London. One of the things I hope you'll notice in the three previous films of Before the Parade Passes By was the Gower Champion choreography that followed with the productions, even though Gower Champion has been dead for about 35 years.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure this year to welcome back to London's West End a lady who actually first made her name in 1950 as Lorelei Lee, as the legendary flapper in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. She continued her career in films with Thoroughly Modern Millie and then became an international theater and cabaret star, very much in her own right, as much at home in Las Vegas, in Broadway, on Broadway, and here in London. Well, she was last seen here in London in 1970 with her 10 stout-hearted men. And she has returned this year to the Theatre Royal Drury Lane with her own very personal portrayal of Dolly Levi. Who else can it be, ladies and gentlemen? The one and only Miss Carol Channing, and hello, Dolly.
Your lips flowing, your lips flowing.
to 14th Street and into my personal hate. But now that I'm back in the light of 14th Street, tomorrow will be brighter than the good old days.
Hello, 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 hello.
Glad to see you, Hank. Let's thank my lucky star. You're looking great, Stanley. Dolly's overjoyed and overwhelmed and overpowered.
I hear the arms of the law, and I still get back to from a handsome man. So,
golly gee, fellas, find me a bacon.
Well, you know, that Carol Channing, she certainly did make that into something for herself. And it was really Louis Armstrong that put the song on the map. And, you know, hard to imagine that really happened. The Tony Awards became very contentious that year because it was up against Funny Girl. And David Merrick had dropped out of the Funny Girl production. And the competition between Funny Girl and Hello, Dolly was outrageously tense. And the assumption was they didn't have to really pay attention to Streisand because she'd be back. Of course, that didn't happen. Well, Carol Channing, because of Hello, Dolly and Jerry Herman writing it, for the next and the rest of her life, milked it any time that she could. There is a plagiarism suit, however, that Jerry Herman lost, or they settled out of court, claiming that he copied the song. He paid $250,000 for that, but no one really has paid much attention to it since. So Mary Martin, after turning down Hello, Dolly, is offered the opportunity to take Hello, Dolly on a world tour. It goes to Japan, it goes to Vietnam, and she opens it in London in 1965. She's the first replacement Dolly. Well, There were other replacements as well. First, it was Ginger Rogers, Betty Grable, Martha Ray. That's Ginger Rogers in the part. And this is how this was presented as a big promotional gimmick on What's My Line.
And now, from New York, let's meet our What's My Line panel. First, the popular columnist whose voice of Broadway appears in papers coast to coast, Miss Dorothy Kilgallen.
Left one of the most delightful stars of television and records, Mr. Mike Douglas.
And I'd like to introduce a very lovely lady who spent a week with me as my co-star on my program, who opens tomorrow evening at the Mount Tom Playhouse in Holyoke, Massachusetts, in a new play called Mrs. Dolly Has a Lover, the enchanting Arlene Francis.
You learned your part real well. And now one of the joys of Sunday night for all of us, and I know for all of you out there too, the publisher of Random House, Mr. Bennett, sir.
Host looks a little bit exhausted tonight. There's a very good reason for it. The first place, he was running the Miss Universe show in Miami last night. And the second place, he spent the rest of the week up at Sing Sing Prison trying to get a bunch of convicts up there to challenge the Army football team to a football game this fall because he wants to prove once and for all that the pen is mightier than the sword. Here he is, fresh from his universe, John Charles Daly.
Bennett, if you keep that up one of these days, you'll become familiar with Sing Sing, I think. Somebody will do violence, or you'll have to do violence. But we did. We had a lot of fun down at Miss Universe. By the way, all of the Fontainebleau Sunshine and Chowder Club, Carl and Arnie and Mr. O'Malley sent you their regards and say, please come back. They want to put some muscles on you. And I said, you needed it.
Thank you.
And Mr. Douglas, nice to have you there, sir.
Thank you, John.
Hope you have some fun on this first outing. In view of the fact that this is your first outing, we're going to give you some surprises tonight. So get your blindfolds ready for the first go-round. We have some interesting occupations, but more than that, we're going to have two famous mystery guests before you on the panel tonight. And we'll meet our first mystery guest after this word. All right, panel, as I told you, we're going to depart from our usual custom tonight and have two mystery guests, so you are required to be blindfolded immediately. Are the blindfolds in place?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, indeed.
All right, will our first mystery guest enter and sign in, please? You already know, but for you particularly, Mike, we use a different form of questioning with a mystery guest, one question at a time, in turn moving clockwise. And we will begin with Bennett Cerf.
May we assume that some part of your career, past or present, you have been a star on the Broadway stage?
Oui. Ms. Kilgallen.
Have you been on the Broadway musical stage?
Oui. Mr. Douglas?
That's a female voice. Is this a...
Don't take anything for granted.
Is this a leading lady?
Oui. Miss Francis?
She's not a wee leading lady either, I don't think. Are you about to open in a musical that has been very successful already on Broadway?
Mm.
Are you related in a kind of mysterious way to Bennett, sir?
That's question number two, Miss
Gratz. Yes, you can't ask that question.
Sorry, but that's...
Let me ask that. All right. Are you related to a very close relation of mine, namely my wife?
No.
No?
Well, we'd have to stay in a way, maybe, perhaps, and how. Miss Kilgallen.
Well, are you Ginger Rogers?
Well, I think we're caught well up the tree now, and I'm out on the limb, and somebody's got
Well, you either are or you aren't Ginger Rogers.
No. Maybe there are two people there.
Are there two people?
Maybe it's...
Ginger and Carol?
Ginger and Carol.
You see, I was in a very difficult position, Bennett, because actually Carol answered your question very properly. No, but Ginger is also the mystery guest, so that it's like...
I wish Carol was my relation to...
John, did the first we belong to Carol?
The first we belong to Carol, yes.
It's awful, John. You have such problems.
That's why I'm aged.
Look at you sitting there with those two beauties.
Gosh, what a lovely picture. Are they going to sing Hello, Dolly right now together?
Well, you have to remember that, first of all, wasn't What's My Line an elegant Sunday evening send-off, but What's My Line was used for promotional events of Broadway musicals and movies and so forth. And when David Merrick was switching Ginger Rogers in for Carol Channing, he went all out on it. After Ginger Rogers, there was Betty Grable, then there was Martha Ray, Phyllis Diller, who didn't do so well with the part, Eve Arden, there's Eve, and then, of course, you know, the Pearl Bailey cast, David Merrick, people were losing interest in Dolly, and David Merrick wasn't ready to let it go yet. He thought there was a lot more in it that could happen. So that's when Pearl Bailey came in, and of course, we showed you the Pearl Bailey version a little bit earlier. But the all-black Hello, Dolly in 1967 was absolutely the biggest thing going. And, of course, it made the cover of Life. And this is just the Pearl Bailey Tony. I think you'll get a kick out of this.
Did this ever happen to you? Did you ever have a very favorite dress and you gave it to a friend? And this friend took it home. And she shortened the hem and changed the buttons and dyed it another color. And the next time you saw this dress, you were completely bowled over with how great it looked. I mean, not that it didn't look good before, but a few changes here and there, and it had a whole new life. Well, that is exactly what happened to me and not too long ago. And I want for you to see it too. Ladies and gentlemen, I am proud and excited and happy to present tonight the new company of Hello, Dolly, and my dear close friend, Miss Pearl Bailey.
Out there, there's a world outside of Yonkers, way out there beyond the slick town, Barnaby. There's a slick town, Barnaby. For shine and for sparkle, close your eyes and see it. Listen, Barnaby. Listen, Barnaby.
Now, just a note about this, you know, you've seen several versions of this. Most recently, we showed you a clip from the Bette Midler revival, and you notice the Gower Champion choreography was intact. It's the same thing with the pastel multicolored costumes, and that's the way it was. Well, Merman kept her promise, and after she told David Merrick she wouldn't do it, she took it on and was the last Dolly on Broadway in the original run of Hello, Dolly. Well, Dolly the movie. Well, we all know that Carol Channing wanted to make the movie, but they just didn't see that Carol Channing was going to be the person. The 2.5 hours of her on film was just not going to work. The movie had all kinds of harsh terms going with it, And Jerry Herman even wrote two new songs, and they wanted novelty casting, which is how Streisand got the part. She never really wanted it. She thought she was wrong for the part. She and Walter Matthau had no chemistry together. They didn't get along at all. And it was, hoped that Hello, Dolly would become the next Sound of Music for 20th Century Fox. It had to sit in the can because it didn't get shown until the Broadway production closed, and the interest that was being paid already was breaking the studio before they could release it. But by the time the Hello, Dolly movie was released, tastes had changed. The Vietnam War was raging. And Streisand, by the way, told 20th Century Fox if they wanted novelty casting, they should get Elizabeth Taylor, who, by the way, might have been pretty terrific. But in any event, the movie did come out. It's not tremendously well regarded at this point in time. She sort of does a Mae West impersonation, and it was just not what anybody thought would make a great movie. Gene Kelly directed it, but Carol Channing waged a bitter campaign to try to rescue the part for herself. And it's that kind of image, that close-up, that kept her from making the movie herself. Well, next week when we get together, we're going to talk about MAME and Mac and Mabel, La Cage aux Folles, and the rest of what Jerry Herman gave us. Does anybody have anything? I'm going to go back and just look at the chats. I'm just looking to see if there's anything else anybody wants me to share. I love the What's My Line clips myself. And Carol Channing just died about a year and a half ago. She was one of the last of the 1940s group. She was wonderful. And, I wanted you all to have a good sense of what, these differences were. By the way, Gower Champion, I'm doing a class for Oasis on Gower Champion. You may want to participate in that and register next Thursday, I believe. He liked steps and he liked props. So in the original that I showed you, you notice that there was the actors dressed as the horse in the parade. Dolly had to descend down the steps. Many of the scenes in Dolly use levels and steps because that's something that Gower Champion really, really liked. Yes, the question was, am I going to send a copy of the presentation? I always send it out today. If it has recorded and recorded well, I'll send it out later this afternoon. But that's kind of it. Anybody have anything else you want to know or want me to answer? I'm, willing to do it. Well, I'm glad, Jerry Herman wrote Happy Music. So it was great to enjoy Happy Music this morning with you and the music of Jerry Herman. And again, next week, we'll start with MAME. There's a lot of great music with MAME as well, and we'll have a good time. See you all next week, everybody, and really tell your friends about what we do, and maybe you can have some of them join us. Take care. Bye-bye.